So before we bring Dr. Botla on, I just want to kind of talk a little bit about, you know, mental health issues and why it's important for me to be sitting in this chair. And I think, you know, I think during the pandemic, and today was a great example. Like, I woke up and Mark Borowiecki is not going to relate to this because now he's a Nashville guy and it's like 25 degrees Celsius. But I think for those of us who woke up in Ottawa today, it was a tough day and there was snow on the ground and our kids are homeschooling and we can't go out. And it's hard. And it's really hard, I think, sometimes on dads, because we're often seen as the ones that have to be strong and we're not the ones that are supposed to show emotion. But it's what we're going to talk about today is that it's okay. It's okay to show emotion. But it's amazing to me how the role of fatherhood has really changed. Like, I think back to when I was a kid, like 80s and 90s. Like, sometimes I think to myself, I wish I could go back in time. Imagine being a dad and like, or even like if you were a dad in the 70s, you had it made. All you had to do was show up at the delivery room with like a cigar and you're good to go. You've done your job. And now you come into modern day fatherhood and we're expected to be emotional supports. And you know, there's all sorts of things in the toolbox of being a dad in the year 2021 that wasn't there a generation before. So we're kind of like this new generation of dads that are trying our best to kind of evolve. And I think to myself, you know, I'm glad that we're here though, because nights like this are about talking about our feelings, and that's not something dads have done traditionally. And I'm really excited to have this conversation. Hopefully for the dads that are on the other side of this, or even if there's moms listening to, any parent that's listening to this, hopefully you're going to feel empowered to speak up and think about your own situation and how you can, you know, make sure you take care of your own mental health. Now, when we talk about mental health in this city, I don't think there's anybody better than Dr. Raj Botla, who is the Royal Ottawa's chief of psychiatry. We're going to bring in Dr. Botla here. And whoa, he's wearing an Ottawa Senators jersey. I thought that was just for the preamble. But here
I figured I'd go hockey.
I like it. So this is a Daniel. It's a captain. Is that a Daniel Alfredson jersey you're wearing?
It is.
I like it. We know that Alf, you know, one of the things about Daniel Alfredson, I always think about this, Daniel Alfredson, Luke Richardson, and now you're seeing with Mark Borowiecki, we've had a wonderful connection of Ottawa Senators players, past, present, that have been wonderful partners with the Royal and speaking. And again, we're going to get to Mark Borowiecki a little bit later, but Dr. Botla, I would love to hand over the floor to you.
Well, thank you very much, Ian. I'm going to start off by doing something I really shouldn't do, but I'm going to start off with a video, really fun video. It's about dads. It's about kids. You'll enjoy the video. I'm going to ask you to keep an eye on the kids in the video and keep one eye on the dad.
Just wanna say,
Okay, well, hopefully you enjoyed that video as much as I do. It's always fun watching the kids in that video and then also watching the dads who really love the video. I'm next going to have a short PowerPoint, and it'll be a really short talk about a variety of things, a bit about the biology of fatherhood, attachment, the importance of play. And that's why I played the video. You'll see how important it is for fathers and kids, talking a little bit about father involvement, benefits to fathers and to mothers. We'll be going fairly quickly, and there'll be some time for Q&A later, but hopefully you'll enjoy the next little tour about fatherhood. I did want to declare I do have a bit of conflict of interest in this, so these are my conflicts of interest that are okay to be a little bit embarrassed. They're older than that now, but I still see them as my, my conflicts of interest. So biological changes in fatherhood, it's actually really important. We think that only moms go through the hormonal changes in motherhood, and they certainly do. But there are hormonal changes in fathers. The two that are particularly important are oxytocin, the love hormone, or the bonding hormone. And actually that changes in men, and actually changes in particular when they play, interact, or involved with their kids. So their biology actually changes. The other thing that changes when you play with your kid is actually your brain. So your brain is quite plastic. It actually changes a little bit as you interact with your kid, and it reorganizes itself to become a father. So attachment. This was a very wise woman who taught me this about attachment, and I'll just quote this one. So a father's presence, health, and quality of interactions during sensitive periods of fetal and child development places his child on a positive or negative trajectory that influences his or her emotional, behavioral, and physical well-being in adolescence and beyond. So it really matters throughout a kid's life. The author of that, by the way, is my wife. Play. We're going to talk about rough and tumble play. It's not just fun. It is actually really crucial in a child's development. And the rough and tumble play is relatively unique to fathers. And you saw some of that in the video. And this is across cultures, across species. And it really serves an adaptive function and helps cement the bond between father and child. So what is the importance of play? And actually it's remarkably important. It builds trust. So you saw in the video, father holding a kid up by the feet and just loving it. A kid's on skateboards, taking chances, taking risks. So it builds that trust that they can do things. The physical activity is crucial for the kids, and also learning the limits. So your kids learn to wrestle. They learn what's within the rules, what's not in the rules. Sports helps with that a lot. And it's an important part of their development. It also leads to their social intelligence. It creates a certain amount of morality in kids, and actually it grows their resilience. If you'll notice, especially if you have two kids and they wrestle and they're of different ages, they know how much to push each other's buttons in general. You'll get a little bit of crying here and there, but they know how to push each other's buttons and push their physical limits, what is socially acceptable and what is not. Also, it's kind of fun. So you're building bonds, you're creating resilience, and it's a lot of fun. So we talk a lot at the Royal about outcomes. How do you know that something you're doing has a positive effect and makes a difference? Well, here's some of the positive effects of having an involved father. It's demonstrated that an involved father really helps the maturity of children in terms of having higher IQs. Language development is really promoted by the conversations dads have with their kids. And they're slightly different than the mom conversations. And it really grows a child's vocabulary and skill set. Involved fathers also tend to have kids that are academically doing better and involved more in higher learning. They drop out less out of school. They're not suspended or expelled as much as kids with less father involvement. And they tend to be more successful in their careers. Not only is it important for their intellectual development, also in their behavioral development and their emotional maturity. They tend to have fewer behavioral problems, a lot more self-control and frustration tolerance, and you have more adaptable kids, less prone to emotional distress. In the mental health world, we would say they are better emotionally regulated. They tend to be more self-confident and curious. They tend to explore more and take chances. Those of you who watch the Magic School Bus, Ms. Frizz said, I think, take chances, make mistakes, get messy. It still applies, kids and play and fathers. You also have positive relationships with family and peers. Last few things on the effects of involved fathers. You notice kids that are more cooperative, they're more generous. They are actually much more successful later on in life and during adolescence in establishing intimate relationships. They end up in more stable marriages. They end up being more positive role models for their own children and much more resilient in stressful situations. It's really remarkable how much of a difference it makes having an involved father in your life. The involvement is not only important for the child, but also of the father. You'll see fathers who are involved are more involved with their families and their communities. They also do better at work and tend to have less stress at work because they know they have a safe space at home and do better that way as well. There's also a greater sense of well-being and, really importantly, it's a sense of purpose. So everyone in life needs a life of meaning, and there's really nothing more meaningful than doing well by your children and your family. Last couple of slides to point out that it's not just about fathers and the kids. An involved father actually makes a big difference for maternal wellness. It helps in the pregnancy itself and during the delivery. I think Ian mentioned earlier on, you came in with your cigar and you left. Well, you're much more involved now than you ever were in the past, and it actually makes a significant difference. Mothers have a better postpartum experience and better for their mental health. They tend to have greater life satisfaction and happiness, not only with the children, but with their spouse. That's probably self-evident, but it's clearly there. And they have lower levels of stress. And I think it's my last slide. And Mark will probably get a question or two on this, I'm not sure, but really important that fathers also take care of their own health. It really matters. Men don't do as well as women when it comes to chronic disease, but you know what? Fathers that take care of themselves also end up having kids that take care of themselves. So the whole thing with diet, exercise, nutrition, I put a little smiley face on sleep. I remember one of my kids just had a tough time sleeping, and we just had a rough go for a while. But you'll find that overall, if you can do well by the substances and stay away from things that are problematic, you'll do well by yourself, your kids, and your family in general. So I hope I've convinced you a little bit the importance of father involvement and the crucial part of play. So all you really need to do, be involved with your kids and actually have some fun and play with them. It'll make a huge difference.
All right. Terrific stuff, Dr. Botla. I love that video too, right off the top. That was That was fantastic. So I got to ask you here a couple of quick questions. And again, if you have any questions for Dr. Botla based on anything that he said here, put them in our chat. And this is a live event. Put them in the chat. We will be sure to ask those questions to Dr. Botla. But I wouldn't mind, could we bring Dr. Botla here just for 1 second here to wrap this up? Real quick, I just want to ask Dr. Botla about, you know, I made that comment about, you know, back in the day, the dad would show up in the delivery room. All you had to do was like, it's a boy, it's a girl, cigar. That was your work. And, you know, I think of the movie, it came out in the late 80s and it was called Three Men and a Baby. Okay. And the premise of this movie was essentially that, whoa, like men are so incompetent. It takes three of them to raise a baby, right? Like, look at how far we've come that there used to be a movie about bumbling dads that couldn't handle changing a diaper to where we are today. And I wonder, I guess my question to you is just simply the role of maybe the media in helping change the narrative and positive messaging of fathers that we maybe see now in, you know, media versus 20 or 30 years ago, where again, it was like, whoa, dad can't really get things done. And he's kind of a bumbling fool when it comes to changing a diaper.
Yeah, so that's a great comment, Ian. We've come a long way in a short period of time. I remember giving my first sort of male mental health lecture, and you're free to go see that, in 2015 on Conversations at the Royal. And I found a whole bunch of commercials that did show the bumbling dad. And there, you know, you could find them easily. And then a couple of years later, I've done another thing on fathers for Father's Day. That's where that video came from, although it's not my video. And it was harder to find those commercials. And you're increasingly finding a different both television commercials and shows that, you know, depict dads that are involved with their kids and actually pretty good at it. And you just wait post-pandemic. This trend isn't going to change. Dads are liking being with their kids, and kids are liking being with their dads. And I think the moms don't mind it at all.
Yeah. And you know, as we wrap up here, the one point that you had about the importance of sleep, boy, like Mark Borowiecki's old coach used to say, rest is a weapon. And I got to tell you, that is such an applicable statement when it comes to parenting, right? Because when you don't get sleep as a parent, you just feel like you're struggling. And you know, my biggest regret, Dr. Botla, and my wife and I joke about this all the time. Our kids are older now, right? But when they were little, why we didn't get a king size bed, that was our biggest regret, because we always felt like when the toddler, when she was 2 or 3 and she came to sleep with us, she would of course inevitably go starfish, and we're on the sides, we would get a bad sleep. My biggest regret as a dad of when the kids were really young, Dr. Botla, was we didn't get a king bed.
Yeah, same here. We did that for a while, and my two, even as they got a bit older, they came in and joined us. And bigger bed would have helped.
Yeah. Well, listen, Dr. Botla, appreciate that. And Dr. Botla is going to stick around here. And if you have any questions, just put them into the chat. We will get to this with a live interactive session to kind of close out the hour. But we've mentioned his name a couple of times. He's a former member of the Ottawa Senators. And like I said, Luke Richardson, Daniel Alfredson have created a wonderful tradition here of members of the Ottawa Senators in the community here, former players, helping to talk about mental health. And Mark Borowiecki is now a member of the Nashville Predators, but you know that Ottawa is still, front of mind for him, top of mind for him. So Mark Borowiecki, we're going to bring him in, and we're going to find out if Mark Borowiecki now speaks with a Southern accent. Let's find out. Mark Borowiecki, welcome to the show.
No accent, unfortunately. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but very grateful to have been asked to join you guys, and thanks so much for having me.
Yeah. See, I thought you were going to say grateful to join y'all, but y'all. You didn't do that. That's all right. So, hey, listen, we're going to talk about fatherhood and the transition. And I think it's been really tough, obviously, being a new parent in the pandemic with some of the restrictions. But there are a lot of people that are just kind of tuning in and just wondering, what has life been like for the Borowiecki family moving to a new city, new country in Nashville?
No, I appreciate you asking, and you might hear the odd noise in the background. I do have my 14-month-old son roaming around back there with my wife, but it's been an interesting transition. A lot of positive, so many things that we've enjoyed, but some challenges too. I was COVID positive right around Christmas. Unfortunately, I brought it into the household. My wife was positive. You know, we had a lot of worry about Miles. So, my son Miles. So, you know, that was a big, kind of a stressor for us. Once we were able to get through that, you know, any time your personal life, your home life is kind of changed, you know, to the capacity that it was for us. You know, we spent 11 years in Ottawa, to move to a new city. You know, we kind of went through those usual ups and downs, but, you know, Nashville's been so welcoming to us, the community here. You know, it's certainly a very livable city. There's tons of things to do for families, you know, to the extent that we can enjoy them during COVID, but we've definitely enjoyed it.
You know what? And I think what's great about this too, Mark, and I mentioned Daniel Alfredson, Luke Richardson, there's been some others, but when we get National Hockey League players coming out to speak about mental health, I think it's a good thing. And I thought, you know, boy, your old teammate, you played with him briefly in Robin Lehner, certainly came out this week and talked about some challenges and issues that players are facing. And I guess the question I would ask you is, look, you're a professional athlete. How does Mark Borowiecki manage mental health?
It is an interesting question, and obviously this year is very unique. You know, there's less chance to socialize with your teammates. There's less chance to form that connection off the ice. So I think you've had to adjust a little bit. You know, there's a few different things that I personally have found success with. You know, I'm the kind of guy who can get consumed by my job, by the expectations I place on myself, the stresses of being a professional athlete. So for me, you know, it's very important. It's vital for me to have hobbies and interests that kind of take my mind off the game of hockey when I'm not at the rink. You know, I love bikes. I love mountain biking. I love reading. I love history, stuff like that. You know, things that seem kind of small and trivial, but I think for me, it really added up over the years and keeping that sort of work home life balance. And, you know, this year, again, has had its challenges, but, you know, a good opportunity to kind of throw yourself into some of those at-home hobbies.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that you talk about riding a bike to kind of change up your routine, because people would think, oh, a professional athlete, he probably doesn't do something physical to break up the routine, but it's probably a nice little escape for you. Now, do you go on a family bike ride or do you go just you? How does the bike ride work for you?
Typically family. My wife Tara has a mountain bike as well. We haven't really been doing any mountain biking, but as I do have my 14-month-old son on the back of my bike, so I'm not sure going up and down mountains is probably the smartest thing to do at this point. But yeah, you know, it's just a nice little escape for us. There is, I think, something to be said for making sure you're conserving energy when you're not playing or at the rink, but you know, we're just kind of pedaling around the neighborhood, enjoying ourselves. I'm such a big believer in fresh air and sunlight and sort of that, you know, holistic whole body approach to not just, you know, mental health, but physical health too. It's been key for me kind of in coming back from injuries. And I just think it's so applicable for mental health as well. And, you know, to have hobbies like that, just kind of getting out and having that kind of escape outside, it's definitely helped.
Okay. So Mr. Fresh Air, you weren't here in Ottawa today. We woke up to snow.
I heard your segue and, you know, I'm not envious. I don't really feel that bad for you because I grew up and lived in Ottawa for so long, but yeah. I've definitely been enjoying the 20 degree days here. You know, it rains once a week and I get real mad about it. And then I realize how spoiled I am. So it's been nice.
I'm not going to lie to you. I can see a little reflection in behind you and I can see green trees or something. I'm like, I'm getting angry looking at that because I know that it's nice weather down there. Hey, look, you got drafted in 2008 into the National Hockey League, which I think you kind of come in at an interesting time because probably 10, 12 years ago, Mark, there wasn't a lot of talk about mental health in a locker room, in the hockey environment. It was very much a testosterone-fueled environment. And so people want to know, what's it like now? Is there a culture that now, if Mark Borowiecki is struggling with his mental health, if he's feeling anxious, he can go to a teammate? Or is that still something that the hockey world kind of says, like, you know what, man, you're not a tough guy?
It really is an interesting question, and it's certainly shifted. You know, I think anyone who doesn't, you know, realize that or say that or accept that is wrong. You know, there's still this sort of inherent, you know, sort of masculinity to hockey. you know, guys take a lot of pride in this big tough guy persona and playing through injuries. And I think sometimes that translates into, you know, well, I've got to play through mental health injuries too. You know, I can play through a broken bone in my foot. So why can't I play through anxiety or obsession or, you know, any of these mental health issues? You know, the conversation is definitely much more open. I still think as a sport, and, you know, I think that's reflective as of society as a whole. I think we have a ways to go for sure in being more open about it. But definitely there's a lot of guys in every dressing room around the league who have dealt with these issues, who are currently dealing with these issues and very open to talking about them and helping their teammates.
So maybe you could talk a little bit about the pressures of a National Hockey League player. And, you know, when you play at the highest level, I think there's a pressure that comes with it. What's that like? I mean, do you get the classic signs of pressure and anxiety that, you know, regular people like us would get about maybe, you know, something big, a presentation? I think that the one thing that people could probably relate to in this conversation would be if you have to give a presentation or something in a group setting and you get that feeling of like the palms are sweaty and the heart is racing and like that. Do you experience those types of things as an athlete, or is that kind of gone away, or how does that manifest itself for you?
Yeah, that's very relatable. You know, I think it's sort of that anticipatory anxiety, right? You know, you have something important, something big coming up. And for us, that's a game almost every second night. And to be completely honest, for a lot of players in this league, unless you're a superstar, you have to perform in practice too. You know, you're constantly being watched, you're constantly being evaluated. So certainly we all experience those feelings and emotions to our own extent. You know, it's just one of these things where I think you need to find ways to deal with these emotions and cope with them. I know for me, I've had my most success when I've reached out for outside help, when I've accepted that, hey, you know, feeling these emotions are perfectly okay. It's part of the human experience. Now it's how do I manage these emotions? And for me, it's people who I trust offering resources and help, and that formula has seemed to help.
You know, I think it's really interesting too. Like, you have to deal with, and whether it's you know, I'll say it, like whether it's criticism from media people or fans or social media. How do you handle that element of your job where people, like, let's be honest here, people aren't always nice, Mark. People are mean. People are can lash out. People can say some nasty things. How do you guard against letting your own self-esteem be affected by outside negativity from passionate hockey fans?
Yeah, Twitter sucks, right? I don't think I'm too off base saying that. It's a bit of a rabbit hole for sure. And I'll be completely honest. I really, really struggled with that early in my career. You know, I had much more of an online presence. I surrounded myself with that stuff. I was on Twitter a lot. And you're never going to make everyone happy. And I think the sooner I came to realize that, the better and healthier it was for me personally. You know, it's just one of those things where you have to keep your focus inwards to a certain extent, realize that what you're doing, you know, your success and your happiness is dictated by yourself and your own thoughts. And also, you know, the people who are important, you know, who are evaluating you, your coaches, your peers, you know, your GM, those are the opinions that you should really worry about and be concerned about, not, you know, online talk and stuff like that.
Yeah, I think it's really important. People sometimes think because you're professional athletes and you make, you know, X amount of dollars that it somehow makes you immune to criticism. And it's not true, right? Like, I think people forget professional athletes are human beings, and sometimes we treat you like a commodity or a cap hit, and it's really not the case, right?
Yeah, I mean, we're all human beings. You know, I always kind of laugh when I see a young kid who's pumped to see me, or someone's like, "Oh, you play in the NHL," and you know, I'm just a normal guy, just a normal dude who happens to have a unique skill set that allows me to play a game for a living. You know, when guys still have emotions, experience emotions, we all feel these thoughts of anxiety and nerves and obsession and stress. And you know, I always think it's a good thing if if in any capacity we can kind of remind ourselves that empathy and compassion kind of go a long way. And that translates to online talk too, you know, just take some time to think about what you're going to say and how it might affect someone emotionally.
You know, I think emotions probably came to the forefront for you when you guys had your first son. What has that been like for you? Miles is what, 14 months old now?
14 months. Yeah. It's, I mean, it's just been awesome. It's been so fulfilling for me. You know, he was born February, just pre-pandemic. So in that respect, I was fortunate that I got a lot of time with him. You know, a lot of time that a lot of working fathers don't get. I'm certainly grateful for that, and I was spoiled by it. And I found that first road trip away from him this season particularly tough. I hadn't been away from him. That was really challenging. I kind of underestimated how much I would miss him and being with him. And I think it took a toll on me personally, emotionally, and also my on ice play. But having said that, you know, every month, every week, every day, like, he's growing, developing, he's doing new things. And it's just really, you know, I felt my whole world kind of flip in a positive way. You know, my priorities and perspectives are changing constantly. And you know, I just have so much love for him, and it's been awesome.
When you were away on the road, that first road trip, like, how did you connect? Were you constantly on FaceTime? Like, what was that like for you?
A lot of FaceTime. He's probably sick of me now. I think my wife's probably sick of my face on my ugly mug on FaceTime too. But you know, FaceTime before bed. Like, I love doing bedtime routines with him. We're pretty structured with that, and how he sleeps and what his bedtime routine is. And I love being a part of that. And I really missed, you know, sitting down to eat dinner with him. So a lot of times we try to plan it where, you know, I'd have my dinner in my room and my wife would be having dinner with Miles, and we kind of have dinner together virtually, right? So that was a huge help to me personally and mentally, and something we kind of continued.
You know, maybe we should have done this as like the, I think there was the old game show, the Newlywed Game, where you would ask the husband a question and then you would ask the wife a question and see if it lined up. If I asked, let me just ask you this, the percentage of diapers that Mark Borowiecki has changed in the first 14 months, are you a 50% guy, 25% guy, somewhere north of 50? Give us an honest, because we can easily go to Tara and get the real answer here.
I'm pretty good, man. I think she would give you the same answer. I take a lot of pride in being a hands-on dad, as I'm sure, you know, many of the guys on this conversation are too. I'm right in there for sure. There's been some messy ones where I had to call in some reinforcements from mom, but a couple of bowel movements that I think have scarred me for a bit. But you know, I really enjoy kind of being hands on, so definitely I don't shy away from that.
Okay, so now how does this play out? Because I remember when our girls were little, you know, sometimes they would get up in the middle of the night and then there would be kind of that conversation with, it's your turn. I did it last time. What's that like? What's the two? It's 2:35 in the morning. Does Mark Borowiecki ever play the I got a game tomorrow card?
Miles is a fantastic sleeper. He sleeps pretty much 7 to 6 or 6 to 6 every night. No, crazy wake ups or anything. So luckily we've avoided the most of that. When he was a newborn, we had an understanding, and actually a lot of hockey players do this too, where mom's on charge on game nights and then dads take over on, you know, nights where there's a practice the next day. Especially being an older guy established in the league, I don't really care if I'm dragging my butt around in practice because I got 4 hours of sleep. I'll tell coaches exactly what's going on and give them a piece of my mind because I'm tired and I need a coffee. And I'm irritable, but that's kind of the trade-off.
That's funny. That sounds like it's part of the CBA. wives take care of the babies on game nights, and non-game days, dads step in. So, you know, I think what's really great too, and you mentioned that you've moved away from Twitter, but you're very active on Instagram, right? You're a pretty active guy on Instagram. And I think what's really cool is that in your social media feed, you're a very... I'm going to use the word progressive. You're a progressive hockey player. You share messages of empathy, of inclusion, of mental health, things that you don't often see hockey players do. And I want to know kind of how social media, in a good way, has helped you maybe amplify some messages and maybe try and share a message of positivity through Instagram.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I appreciate the recognition and the chance to kind of continue talking about it. And you know, I think, again, this kind of, for me, it goes back to this like stereotypical hockey image where it's like, oh, hockey players are these farm boys from Saskatchewan. They're the strong, silent type, you know, generally don't have a lot of opinions, maybe shy on some brain cells. Like, I've got no teeth and a crooked nose. Who cares about my opinions or what I have to think, right? But I've said this to you in the past, you know, I do have a brain. It's working, and I do like to use it, and I like to be socially aware and politically aware and stuff like that. And, you know, Instagram's kind of given me a good opportunity to connect with people who might not have known this stuff about me otherwise. You know, and I don't think I'm doing anything extra special. You know, I get that maybe it's not normal for a hockey player to be vocal or outspoken, but you know, again, I just think I'm a normal guy, and these are just values that I've been raised with, and my parents instilled in me, and Tara, my wife, and I, as parents, are trying to instill in Miles, you know, values of empathy and compassion and inclusion and acceptance, you know, just basic stuff. I think that, you know, we all kind of strive for to be a good human being. And if I can kind of pump that stuff up on Instagram, I'm all for it.
You know, one of the best conversations I think ever had with you was just around the Senators had a hockey. It might have been their first Hockey Is for Everyone night a couple of years ago. And you and I did one of our kind of radio chats, borrowed time, smash hit on TSN 1200. And I remember you talking to me about why it mattered to you that you advocated for the LGBTQ community. And where I want to bring this into mental health is, you know, there's a lot of people, young people, that struggle with that. And when they hear a National Hockey League player coming out and using his platform, whether it's a radio interview on 1200 or his Instagram saying, love is love, and who am I to tell people who they can and can't love? I think you need to understand that you might try to pass yourself off as I'm just a regular guy. The stuff that you have said has absolutely landed with young people in our community and beyond. And I think that they're very appreciative of you using your platform in that way.
That means a lot to me. It really does, more than I can say. And, you know, I think I kind of, you know, expressed this to you back in the day during that conversation. And it was like, you know, being in a loving relationship has been so fulfilling for me on so many different levels. And to tie it back into mental health, like, you know, I've kind of hemmed and hawed about how candid I want to be about my struggles with mental health, you know, on this particular call or in public. And, you know, I'll just say that I continue to have my own struggles. You know, Ian, you've known about that a little bit. And for me, it's like Tara, my wife, my partner, she's been my rock through all this. And without her, you know, I'm not sure, you know, what my life would look like. And who am I to deny someone that opportunity, you know, to be in a loving, fulfilling relationship and have that resource and opportunity to lean on a partner because of their sexual orientation? I mean, to me, that just seems so wrong on many levels, and that's a big reason why I try to be, you know, an ally.
You know, you talked about a moment ago too. You talked about how your parents instilled empathy into you. People would love to know, what was Mark Borowiecki's dad like? It's Tom, right? Tom's your dad.
Tom, yeah.
Yeah. So, give us the scouting report on Tom Borowiecki, father.
Oh, I'm pretty sure he's listening to this right now. So now's my chance to air out the dirty laundry, eh? But my dad is, you know, an incredibly thoughtful, you know, intelligent man. And he was always so kind from a young age. You know, I don't think he was caught up in this masculine persona. You know, my dad kind of had that traditional gender role where he went off to work. You know, my mom was a stay-at-home mom. She was the homemaker. My dad would go off to work. When he came home, he always took time to be a loving, involved father. And, you know, it's funny. I was just on a trip a couple of days ago. I'd driven out to see a specialist for an injury I'm dealing with. And I wanted to stop somewhere and get Miles something from a place I'd been, a city that I'd never been to. And I got him an Ohio State little, like, squishy novelty football. And, you know, the reason I wanted to do this was because I had so many cool things from my dad's business trip. You know, I had a rugby ball from when he went to Australia. I had a boomerang from Australia. I had a Baltimore Orioles jersey. You know, he would bring me coins home from Japan, and he instilled this, I think, you know, this desire to want to share these experiences with my son. And I'm very thankful for that. So, you know, I owe a lot of how I try to be a father to my father.
Yeah. And listen, I want to remind people, get your questions in here. We're going to bring Dr. Batla back in here in a second. Any questions that you have, any questions you have for Mark Borowiecki about being a dad or mental health questions, you have a wonderful opportunity to interact here with the National Hockey League player. As we wrap up here and get set to bring in Dr. Batla, I just want to leave you with this kind of open-ended question here, Mark, about, you know, sometimes as guys, we don't like talking about mental health. And I think we've come a long way in the last few years. Is there a final kind of tip or piece of advice that you want to share with the people that are watching this right now?
Yeah, and I'm glad you asked that. And, you know, I'd sat down weeks prior to this and tried to come up with kind of some ideas and you know, things that I wanted to mention. And I think the big one for me that I kept circling back to was, and I think Dr. Batla had mentioned this too, it's this recognition and this acceptance that it is okay to not be okay. You know, accepting that you know, these stressful, these anxious emotions, you know, these issues with mental health are kind of an essential part of the human experience. You know, that's perfectly normal. Now, I think for me in my life, the next step has been, how do I deal with these issues if they're persistent? And for me, it's realizing that asking for help is not a sign of weakness. You know, it really is a sign of strength and maturity and, you know, trust that there's people out there who love you and want to help you and want to be a resource for you. And it certainly helped me and any father out there, young father who's struggling with some of these same issues, you know, I really hope that it can do the same for you too.
Well, that's, you know, it's well said. And I think, and I know you're a super humble guy, but you just need to understand that the importance of when you get a National Hockey League player who plays a rugged style, being willing to talk about his feelings and emotions, it's important. These are important things to break down. So, Mark, thanks so much for taking a few minutes here. We're going to keep you on, though, because we're going to take some questions. But thank you, I think, on behalf of everybody that's watching here. Thanks for being open and talking about your kind of path to fatherhood.
Thank you, guys. I really appreciate the opportunity and having me on and listening to me ramble a little bit. So thank you.
All right. So let's bring in Dr. Batla here. And again, we've got some of your questions here. Dr. Batla will come back in here. And I think we'll also have Mark Borowiecki and myself. And we'll kind of tackle some of the questions here as we go along. So get your questions into the chat. Actually, I'll ask Mark this question first, and we'll go to Dr. Batla, because we've got a question here about controlling the terrible twos. And how do you worry about the temper tantrums? Now, Miles is a little bit shy of the terrible twos, but I want to know, he's kind of getting into that range, Mark. How's the discipline going as his little personality starts to come out?
Yeah, he's definitely getting very independent, very, you know, headstrong and strong-willed. I'll attribute that to his mother. I'm certainly seeing that a little more. You know, he gets something that he wants or that he's locked in on, he wants to do. And if it's something that he's not allowed to have, you know, the temper tantrum comes. I'm definitely not in the terrible twos yet, but, you know, for us, it's kind of being firm, you know, with discipline, but also, you know, making sure it's coming from a loving place and, you know, making sure that it's still supportive and kind.
Have you ever thought about taking the teeth out to scare him and then teeth in when you're in a good mood? Yeah.
About a week ago was the first time he'd ever seen me with my teeth in, actually. And he was very curious about them. He was trying to pull them out of my mouth. So I'm not sure that would work.
Amazing. Dr. Batla, let me ask you that question, because again, the question was, hey, what's the best piece of mental advice that you could give, or what's the best way to control terrible twos for temper tantrums if you're a dad?
Okay. It's been a while since the terrible twos, thank God. But, I would say it's A, recognizing it's pretty normal, right? Kids are turning into individuals more and more. But instead of the no, it's nice to give kids as much as possible choices, right? So you can give a kid a choice, and within a range of things, you can probably say yes and get through that stage. Most important piece of advice is the terrible twos do pass. So you do get through it. But it's nice to get through it unscathed.
Yeah. By the way, three is no picnic either. Like, people talk about the terrible two, three is tough. But once your kids get to like I always think like five is such a, like, once they're kind of like in that senior kindergarten age, it's such a great time. Like, to me, that and when they're like between 5 and 9 or 10, it's just, that's the best time because they still need you, they still depend on you, and they're a little bit independent. That's my favorite kind of window. I mean, all the windows are great, trust me. Even I have two teenagers and I love it. You're gonna hear people scare you off about teenagers. It's, you know what, it's really fulfilling. Okay, we got another question here. Actually, here's one for Mark, and this one comes in from Steve, who wants to know, hey Mark, what's your best advice for a new dad? My kids are a little bit older, but I do have several friends who are welcoming their first child, and I would love to pass on a message to them about being a new dad.
So I'd actually kind of sat down and thought about this and come up with a couple of things. And one thing I'll say is I'm super fortunate that I have a close group of friends, three other guys who I'm very tight with, who are all new dads, who are all young fathers. And to have someone who's experiencing these same things as you and going through these same things and someone to kind of relate to and talk to things about has really meant a lot to me. And sometimes it's in a joking manner and sometimes it's in a more serious manner. But I think if you can make those connections with other young fathers, it goes a long way. And I'll circle back to something I said earlier. For me, it's just kind of this time outside playing with Miles, being with Miles and Tara. You know, I love being outside. I love being in the sunlight. I think doing things outdoors and being active with them has been good for my mental health, which in turn I think sets me up to be a better father too. So, you know, taking care of your own mental health in order to be the best father that you can be, I think is very important.
Yeah, that's fantastic advice. Dr. Botla got another question here. And, you know, Mark talked about how great his dad, Tom, was with him as a child. But not everybody is as fortunate. And I was very lucky. I had a dad who just, you know, would get up at 6 a.m. to take me to hockey practice or do, you know, all the things. But not everyone has that. And this, I think, is a really pertinent question. It says, hey, guys, I'd like to talk about how do you break poor parenting traits that we may have inherited from our own dad. So Dr. Butler, let's say you had a less than ideal dad or a dad who did some things that weren't so great. How can these people who are now parents break some of those traits and habits?
Yeah, so, well, first off, you're not bound to repeat everything. So you have a certain amount of advantage knowing how you wanna be a dad if you have a role model that perhaps you were not as pleased with. So if you still make the effort into, the main one is being involved. And it sounds, most people who are not that pleased with their dads tend to feel that they were not very involved or didn't care or whatever else they may be thinking. So you are not bound by that same pattern. And I think it's important for people to realize that you can be the dad you want to be.
Here's a question that comes in from Matt, who says, we're awaiting the birth of our first child, could be any day now. What's the number one piece of advice to make the best transition from being a couple to now being parents? So maybe, Mark, I'll ask you, look, my piece of advice, get a king-size bed. That's my piece of advice for you, Matt. But Mark, I'll start with you, then I'll go to Dr. Botla. Mark, if the question from Matt is, what's the number one piece of advice to make that transition from a couple to now being a mom and dad?
Yeah, this is something that's very personal to me because I still struggle with this, but I think it's communication and not being so sensitive to feedback and constructive criticism. And I struggle with this very much, but I think it's important to remember that you and your partner are a team in this. You know, I take a lot of pride in doing my best to be a good father, but I know I have shortcomings. And when my wife, you know, points out mistakes or things that maybe I need to work on or get better at, you know, don't get sensitive. Don't let your pride get in the way. Important to remember that you guys are a team together, and that'll just make things go a lot smoother. And I know it's certainly helped us.
Dr. Botla, best piece of advice for somebody making the transition from, hey, they've been a couple, they've been together for a long time, and now suddenly they're a mom and dad.
Yeah. So I just absolutely love Mark's answer on that one. So if you can be on the same page, because you're no longer a couple, you're parents. And what you brought into the world is the most important thing for most people. And if you can get on the same page on how you're going to parent and how you're going to interact, divvy up the duties, I think you're going to be in great shape. But things are different and you got to accept that.
Yeah, and you know what? And on all seriousness, other than the king bed, the thing I would say is make sure you make time for yourselves as a couple. Don't get lost in being mom and dad. You're still the couple and make sure you, and I know it's obviously tough during COVID, but to make date nights, to make the dinners and to do the things that you were doing. Cause sometimes I think it's, and Mark, you're probably dealing with this where when you have a newborn and it's like, it's sometimes it's just about, I just need to get to 7 PM. Okay. I just need to get to bath time and put the kid to bed, and you're just in survival mode. Right. And sometimes you don't take the time to maybe have those little romantic moments or the little dinners or the little movies and the date nights. Right.
Yeah. I think you said it. It's like, okay, how early can Miles go to bed and still sleep through the night? You know, one of those things, but, I think you said it. I'm not sure for all the other fathers out there, Tara and I love to cook. I enjoy cooking, something fun some nights. You know, we have dinner with Miles a lot, but maybe push dinner back. You know, if you don't want to go out, you're not comfortable going out, you don't have a babysitter, you can't go out because of COVID. You know, we make our own little date night at home. We cook something fun. We cook something new. We have a nice meal together after Miles has been to bed. You know, we watch a show that we've recorded, and it definitely helps.
What is Chef Mark Borowiecki's specialty here?
I don't know if I have a specialty. I'm pretty all over the place. I really enjoy trying to find like authentic, like cultural ethnic dishes and making them. So I have this like running folder of bookmarks of all these crazy things. And luckily Tara is pretty adventurous and pretty much stomachs any weird concoctions I come up with. So.
Okay. This is a question actually. And again, Mark and Dr. Botla can handle this one, but Mark, this one's probably a little bit more fresh in your mind than it would be for myself or for Dr. Botla. And that is, this is from Curtis, who says, look, we're expecting a child in August. What's your advice for a dad to be in the lead up to having a kid? And how do you maintain your mental health and understanding and helping your pregnant partner? So what was that like for you, Mark, as you led up to, and you said it was February of 2020. So what were the 3 or 4 months before that leading into it like for you?
I think it can be a little challenging, at first, because there's so much focus on and attention and rightfully so on your wife and that baby that soon to be born baby. And it's, for me, it was like, how do I become useful and how do I do what I need to do to help my wife through this? And, you know, again, I'm just going to put it back to communication. Instead of trying to sit there and figure out, okay, like what does Tara need from me? Like how do I crack this code and figure out what I got to do to help out? It's, you know, have a candid conversation, ask her, you know, what she needs in terms of support from you. And I just think it's going to help a lot.
Dr. Butler, I'll ask you that question because sometimes we only focus on, after the baby is born. But let's be honest here, like the 8-9 months leading up as you find out you're pregnant can sometimes be a really kind of stressful time and anxiety riddled time for a lot of fathers to be. What are some pieces of a tangible advice we could give to somebody like Curtis here?
Yeah, so especially with the first child, because you really don't know what you're expecting. It gets easier after the first. But with your first child, you really don't know what to expect. And you do get some, different needs from mothers. And I think you have to do what you can to be supportive and back to nothing all that special. But it is special at the end of the day, that communication in terms of what do you need. The food cravings occasionally are true and real. And so you just go with the flow on that. Sounds like Mark and Tara seem to be quite experimental with their food. So that's not an issue. But you know what? Whatever the needs are, I think need to be met and just communicating effectively about that.
It's funny, when my wife was pregnant with our first daughter, it was cinnamon buns. She had a craving for cinnamon buns. So I would go out at all, whenever it was the store was still open or Cinnabon at the mall and pick them up and bring them back. Mark, did Tara have any pregnancy cravings that you can recall?
Deli sandwiches and like whole milk. It was like I had a calf in the house, so a little dairy calf. There's a lot of whole milk being drank.
Okay, a couple of other questions here before we wrap up. Chris wants to know, I'd love to know from some dads here, some coping strategies for anger and frustration as a new parent. I think we tend to talk about the positives of having a child, but when you don't sleep for a few months on end, it's easy to get overwhelmed with anger and frustration. It can be really hard to stay positive and composed around your kids sometimes. So, Mark Borowiecki, and look, again, this is normal stuff. When you're a dad, you know, we've all had that. Maybe you probably haven't had that. I stepped on some Lego moment. That's coming, Mark. You're going to step on some Lego at some point. You're going to be an angry guy. Okay. And when it happens, you're going to remember me and you're like, ah, yeah, I stepped on Lego. So we all go through it. We all go through the frustrations. Do you ever have that where you're just like, you know what? I just need to walk away, step away from the situation. And that way I'm actually helping by not adding fuel to the fire.
Yeah. So for me, it's like, I always try to remind myself that Miles is kind of like a little sponge right now. And, you know, behaviors and things that I display, you know, there's maybe potentially a chance that he's going to absorb those and pick up on that. So I try to be mindful of that. But, you know, I think another big thing for a lot of young fathers is, you know, I think it's okay to, you know, talk to your wife and figure out a schedule where maybe you can go out, you know, once a week, twice a week, an hour a day, and do something that's going to be good for your mental health. Because again, I think if you take care of your own mental health, you know, as a human being, as a person, you know, in turn, you're going to be in a much better place, you know, to be a positive, supporting, involved father. So I think there's that balance too.
Dr. Butler, just a thought on kind of, you know, dealing with the frustration of maybe your lack of sleep and you've, you know, something's frustrating you on the home front. How you kind of handle that?
Yeah. So we had a period of time where one of ours didn't sleep for a long time, just very poor sleeper. One was a much better sleeper. So one thing is you do get through it, keeping that in mind, because eventually they do sleep. The other thing is you do what you need to do in terms of getting help in if you need, if you have people around, friends, family can be very helpful. And you might have to do a little bit of shift work so you can get some sleep in when you get the opportunity. So you have to coordinate a bit more with a child that doesn't sleep as much. But keep in mind that you do get through it. And it's okay to be frustrated and tired and irritable, because that's just the way it is at that time.
All right. And a final question, actually, Dr. Butler, this one is for you, because I think this is an important one that it's kind of a broad question, but I think hopefully this one lands with everybody. This person has written in, I think I am ready to reach out for help with my depression. What is the first step?
So I tell everyone, and I hopefully this individual has that type of support, can reach out to anyone. But really, if you have a primary care provider, family physician, that's often a really good place to start to get a good assessment, because you may be depressed or there might be a medical condition, get a good evaluation. But certainly, if you're thinking that is something you need to do, I would absolutely do it and don't dawdle on it. Once you're thinking about it, a good assessment can be invaluable.
All right. That's perfect advice and a perfect place to leave this off. Mark Borowiecki and Dr. Raj Batla, this hour flew by. I hope it flew by for you as like it did for me, because this was, I felt like it was pretty fast paced and certainly engaging and informative. Thank you so much to both of you for taking the time to share your unique experiences and expertise on being a dad.
Well, thank you. And Mark, I got to put a shout out to Mark. Just some brilliant answers and well thought out answers. And of course, brilliant questions there, Ian. But Mark, kudos. Just more power to you.
No, that means a lot. And I'm super thankful and grateful. And yeah, it's been fun. And thanks to everyone who tuned in too. You know, it means a lot to have you guys listening in. So thank you, guys.